HBCU Digest Radio, welcome back to another edition of Discussion on Historically Black Colleges and Universities. Today, we are excited to talk sports, a passion of mine and many of you guys out there, from a renowned expert on HBCU athletics and the intersections of policy making in the NCAA. We are privileged to have today Dr. Monique Ositelu. She's a senior policy analyst in the higher education division at the New America Organization, and she has a new report just out last week on the NCAA's on how the NCAA's APR rating eliminates HBCUs from postseason competition in the men's and women's national basketball tournaments, also known as March Madness. So, Doc, we are honored to have you on today.
Thank you so much, Jared. I'm so glad to be part of it. Thank you, thank you. I've been looking forward to this all day.
Well, you do me a great honor saying that, because so many people look forward to booing me or criticizing me on Facebook. So. tell us more about this. This is groundbreaking in several ways. One, it's not the first report you've done, but this is a report that really delves into the more than just the numbers that we see on APR, and how performance academically. And not even academically, sometimes it's just a matter of retention and graduation rates that impacts this APR. But tell us more about this edition of your series of reports that you've done on HBCUs and APR ratings.
Sure. So if it's okay, Jared, just for our listeners that are not really familiar with APR, APR is known as the Academic Progress Rate, which is part of the NCAA's academic reform. And basically, it's a way to monitor, the NCAA's way to monitor academic progress based on two indicators of retention, staying at the same institution each subsequent semester, and then academic eligibility, which refers to maintaining academic progress towards a degree each successive year. And so based on that, each athlete gets a point, and then they have an APR score. And so the NCAA sets a standard of 930 to determine postseason eligibility, and more specific to our context that we have right now, March Madness. And so if you get a 930, you can, you're able to be considered as a team to play in March Madness. But what I have seen in my research, and more particular in this article, I kind of point out that the NCAA has disproportionately banned HBCUs from participating in postseason competition, more specifically March Madness. And so my report looked at 2010 tonight to 2019, and where about 60% of those teams, those basketball teams that have been banned from March Madness, have been minority serving institutions, with 75% of those minority serving institutions representing HBCU men's basketball teams. And so I found that to be very problematic. Not only one, for two reasons. It's problematic. One, it's discriminatory, as we can see that APR has disproportionately disadvantaged HBCUs, which primarily serve students of color, black students in particular, and then it's an inaccurate tool. Like, they're not very sure if this tool definitely is a means to improve graduation rates or is as accurate in monitoring academic progress. And so that's kind of what my article looked at. I also cited another one of my publications in this article. Actually, just a plug, if it's okay.
Absolutely.
This publication that I cited in my article is actually part of a policy series with FAMU. And so it's part of FAMU's Meek Eaton Center, where they have part of their change in social policy that they have going on there. And so this policy brief basically provided statistical evidence that showed that HBCU male teams are disproportionately less likely to achieve this 930 standard. So HBCUs have a 63% probability of meeting it, compared to non-HBCUs have a 99% probability of meeting this standard for postseason eligibility.
And this is just for all Division I programs, correct?
That includes all sports. And so I looked at 8 sports. And so that's basketball, that's football, that's golf, that's tennis, that's track, that's cross country, baseball. So that's all of those 8 sports across all Division I. HBCUs are significantly less likely to meet it for men's teams.
What makes that so scary is that there are only 2 Division I, historically black Division I conferences. Mm-hmm. So you're talking about, you know, no more than 24 teams that are accounting for more than 70% of the banned, I guess, men's teams from postseason eligibility.
Yes.
Your gut reaction to that is obviously, you know, your research expertise in policy reform based on the data that you get. So right away, like, what do you notice that would suggest, hey, look, NCAA, if you want to do better with this, this is one or two things you need to do, or these are one or two things you need to do right away to try to rectify this formula?
Right. I believe just high level, just speaking, it's a need for there to be both race and resource conscious policymaking. So you can't have uniform academic standards across these differentially resourced and differentially mission institutions. And so that needs to be off the bat, something that needs to be addressed. And so if I can go into that a little bit more detail, what do I mean by that? Differentially resourced. So, for example, historically, black institutions, historically black colleges and universities have been underfunded compared to your historically white institutions, HWIs, and some people call them PWIs. And so with that being an issue, you expect them to meet this uniform standard, but they do not have the resources to get there. So another thing is with the resources is that when you look at it from a historical context, okay, so black institutions have historically were created as a sub-educational opportunity. They were never intended to produce doctors, lawyers, policymakers. They were intended to do more of the domestic work, to keep them busy. And so they started off as normal schools, teaching, providing future teachers, not that teacher is a sub profession or anything like that, but that is what black colleges were intended to
teachers, do. Preachers, and farmers.
Exactly. Right. Exactly. So with that being said, what I found in a lot of my historical work is that when the Second Morrill Act came around, the money that was intended to go to HBCUs, quite interesting, actually went to historically white institutions, and some of that money funded their elaborate football stadiums. So HBCUs are already at, I guess, below baseline when it comes to funding. And so then when you speed up and fast forward to now in current context, there is a huge wealth gap as far as institutional wealth. And so they're expected to meet these academic reform policies, standards, but they don't have traveling tutors like more comprehensive, wealthy athletic programs that you see at predominantly white institutions. They don't have the learning specialists at the same level. Their academic advisors, the ratio to student athlete, may be a lot larger compared to your more wealthier athletic programs. Furthermore, all 24 of the HBCUs in Division I, they're all regarded as limited resource institutions. What that means is that they are all regarded as the bottom 15% of athletic budgets for all Division I institutions. Mm-hmm. So the NCAA is aware of these limited resources. They're aware that they do not have as comprehensive academic support services to provide their student athletes, but yet they're still expected to meet this blanket uniform standard. Furthermore, where I regard to race conscious is that this discrimination is not only funneled by financial resources, but there's also this racial stratification that these NCAA bans have against predominantly HBCUs. And so I think that's problematic, and for no other reason, you should be able to see, like, we need to further investigate this. And then I guess you also asked, what do I suggest? I suggest that they use non-discriminatory tools to be able to monitor academic progress. And so a tool that they're already using is academic eligibility. So just seeing how much progress towards a degree each student athlete is making each successive year. That's real time. That's actual data. Are they completing a certain percentage of their degree program by the end of their second year, end of their third year, end of the fourth year? That can be measured. And so that's accurate. We know that that is getting to the end goal of graduation. So things like that needs to be considered, not these standards that are both resource heavy in order to meet these standards and that are penalizing teams in a racially discriminatory manner.
So let's take it from the other side of the equation. And it's so interesting that, you know, this conversation parallels what we're seeing going on with Bennett College and a lot of other HBCUs with accreditation, because some of the conversation is starting to say, well, how biased are the rules, or how little do the rules of accreditation account for low resource institutions and what that looks and feels like? And the NCAA policy making or policy enforcement bears a lot of that same issue. Like, you know, you have rules for, you know, 300 plus Division I teams, but they aren't really written with low resources in mind. And so to that point, at the same token, you know, some HBCUs are having problems with, you know, public funding. Some HBCUs having problem with enrollment stability. Some HBCUs have challenges in being able to adjust athletic fee rates for students. So you can't really get a lot of extra revenue in if you don't have like the corporate support. So how much would you say that those challenges, which are independent of the policymaking, create a scenario where the policies significantly and disparately impact Black colleges, but if some would say not by design, but just because this is what these schools go through?
Yeah, and I also think another piece to add to that is what is the mission of HBCUs, right? Mm-hmm. So the missions of HBCUs tends to be different than your traditional historically white institution. HBCUs tend to give individuals a second chance that may not be able to. Also, HBCUs were intended to offer an opportunity. So HBCUs disproportionately take in a larger number of Black students, minority students, a larger number of low-income students, a larger number of first-generation students, and a larger number of quote-unquote academically at-risk students.
Mm-hmm.
So when it comes to the issues of equity and diversity and access and completion, HBCUs are really doing the work, but they're doing the work with fewer resources. And so that's problematic. And so in regards to the NCAA, when the NCAA created the APR and implemented it in 2004, they were well aware. They have it documented. I've written this in my dissertation. I've written a few other publications. It is documented, written, that the NCAA was well aware that HBCUs would have some challenges mm-hmm. in meeting this APR standard. Mm-hmm. Nonetheless, they still implemented it. Nonetheless, they also increased the standard from 900 to 930 to where it is today,
right.
With that being in mind. So I find that to be very problematic. Not only did they do that, so then they say, okay, fine. We're going to offer you about $1 million grant over the course of 3 years for limited resource institutions. But, Jared, they didn't start implementing these grants until about 2013,
right.
Almost 10 years after they implemented the policy. So it's like now you decided 10 years later, okay, I know we knew from the beginning that resource was an issue. We knew from the beginning HBCUs would find a challenge. But we waited for 10 years after they already have decreased their postseason eligibility presence to then be able to provide some help. And so for me, that's why I do my work,
mm-hmm.
To not only highlight these issues, but to provide empirical research to show that, one, their statistical significance, that they are being disproportionately penalized and they are being disproportionately banned, but also, are they achieving what they're supposed to achieve? And so that's kind of where I feel like my work fits into this conversation.
So what's your take on the conversation that generally results as a product of this conversation, which is, okay, if we can't hang a Division I, and I think we can acknowledge that Division I, even to mid-major programs, they are starting to be boxed out by the Power Five conferences. So mm-hmm. this is becoming a super elite conference of,
yeah.
you know, USC, Notre Dame, and Texas, and all those. Then you got mm-hmm. mid-majors or lower, you know, big state schools and lower Michigan State, Maryland, and all them. Then you have mid-majors like Gonzaga, and then you have us. And mm-hmm. they're slowly trying to cut away at mm-hmm. everybody who's not a big state or an elite program.
Mm-hmm.
So if that is true and it's their rules, what's your take on the folks who say, you know, HBCUs should just say, you know, to hell with all this. Let's go to Division II, you know, and not deal with this. And perhaps, you know, re-envision our business model there rather mm-hmm. than dealing with, you know, this headache and this negative media coverage.
Yeah. So definitely, it's definitely a voluntary membership. You can always go down to another division, or you can go completely to another governing agency. There are a few other governing agencies, NAIA, mm-hmm. USCAA, which is the U.S. Collegiate Athletic Association. Those are other opportunities that you can have membership to. The reason I snickered is because history just repeats itself.
Mm-hmm.
So just real quick, prior to NCAA integrating in 1957, that's when they integrated to allow Black institutions to have membership status in the NCAA. What they did was they created Division II specifically for HBCUs.
Mm.
So you have NCAA membership status, but you're now Division II. So you're already a sub-level to the other white institutions that are there.
Mm.
And so that's kind of why we see MEAC plays amongst themselves and SWAC plays amongst themselves. It's not very often you see, I mean, they do play other white institutions, but they primarily play amongst themselves. And so it's just, what was the initial intention of HBCUs at a NCAA level? They were never intended to be D1. But we have all the laws that have passed, and it's just not fair for them not to be represented. So what do? You use policies as a means of coercion to dismantle HBCU presence, and some critics believe to reduce the presence of black athletes on a Division I level, especially when it's at HBCUs. And so we already see Savannah State is moving down to Division II next year. So I think you're going to continue to see that. I find that very problematic, and I do not think that should be the case, that you should say, you know what, we can't meet this standard, let's move down to Division II, when there's no empirical evidence that suggests this APR standard equates to academic progress. So you're going to move for something that we're not even, that the NCAA is not even sure is an indicator of academic progress. Again, it's just the use of policies as a means to facilitate institutional racism at the advantage of those elite institutions, which you named, to give them more publicity. And what you're going to see is this really a hydraulic displacement of black male talent from HBCUs to those major athletic programs. And so it'll lead to further dismantling of HBCU athletic programs, which were once the beacon of athletics within the black community, to now be shifted to those elite programs and then benefiting those athletic budgets of those programs, which are already wealthy as it is now.
So, I mean, looking ahead, you see a lot of programs are going to have to adjust to this. And we're already dealing with a lot of the fallout. I mean, it's a terrible notion when you see a school say, you know, APR ban, no postseason for, you know, Southern, no postseason for Morgan State, my alma mater.
Yep.
When we know that the game is, such like, you know, I heard this a long time ago. If you want to pass APR for basketball, for example, go get a couple smart guys.
Yep.
Walk them on. Let them graduate in 4 years, and that's part of your score right there. And let the brothers who are going to play, you know, do what they're going to do. But people know how to navigate this.
They do.
And it's understandable that HBCUs don't have the scholarships to do that. They don't have just you know, three or four scholarships just on the, you know, y'all sit on the bench and be the APR
score.
You know.
Yeah.
But so
exactly
what. What can HBCUs do? Because it is starting to become a thing where, as you mentioned, with the $1 million grant program and Coppin and Southern and universities like that have gotten that to some success. It's helped them change some things. And you're starting to see a little more representation on NCAA, you know, rules and infractions committees and championship selection committees. So it's turning slightly. But what could HBCUs do to lobby for more aggressive policy making? What should be the ask? Should it be a different tier of consideration for APR? Should it be APR adjusted overall that could make it easier for some of the larger institutions that know how to game the system? What are some of the things that could be effective to help create more equity for the black colleges?
Sure. So in one of my publications, the one I mentioned earlier, the policy brief with FAMU with their policy series, I actually talk about some of the recommendations that HBCUs can do. And one of the asks that I think that's important is to allow HBCUs, especially institutions with differentially resourced and different missions, to be able to tailor the APR standards, not only to their capacity, but also to what they deem as important. And so I think that it's important that if we do are going to use this APR standard, one, identify if it is doing what it's supposed to do, increasing graduation rates, which my dissertation actually found it does not. And two, if we are going to use this standard, we should be able to allow HBCUs and institutions that are limited resource to be able to tailor the standard that's in their capacity, which they can reach. Otherwise, there are going to happen, like you said, there's loopholes. You're going to get some people where you begin to decrease access, one, to college. Because then you start saying, okay, we have to meet this APR standard, so I only want this specific student, whereas if this standard was never in place, I would have allowed this student to come in. So then now HBCUs are moving away from their mission, which is to provide access, equity, inclusion, et cetera, for students that have been traditionally overlooked. So that becomes problematic with that. So I do think it's important that they do adjust the standards in HBCUs capacity. And also another thing is that the NCAA has penalty filters. So there's waivers, there's adjustments. So for example, if your student athlete's graduation rate for the team, et cetera, is higher than the graduation rate for the institution, the student body graduation rate, then they're allowed to continue to play in postseason. So I think those adjustments, I think those waivers that they have, those penalty filters, I think they are very applicable and continue should be used for HBCUs as they are meeting this APR standard, as long as this APR is in place.
Just to round out everything, do you think that if we adjust HBCUs to be within the filter of, hey, account for lower resources, account for our mission, that it could develop at least a perception of, you know, kind of inferiority? Like, we had to create a new division for you with less stringent standards for you guys to compete. Is there any concern about that, or should HBCUs be concerned about that, or the ramifications of being in a division that it seems like you're less than? Even though it could be argued that some would say we're already there, and it's unfair. Yeah. I mean, because a lot of people say, you know, you're not Kentucky, so you're inferior. Or you're not, you know, you're not Alabama, so you're inferior. Well, I don't know. I don't agree with that. But do you worry if from doing that from a policymaking standpoint emphasizes the point?
I think so. Yeah, I think it would create that. I think it already has actually happened. And just another thing I think that's important to state is not all HBCU teams have this issue in meeting the standard. For example, I've looked at the data. A lot of the female teams are doing well, but there are a lot of female teams that are struggling to meet it. Mm-hmm. But disproportionately, it tends to be the male teams. And I think the issue was when UConn, they won the tournament, and then the following year, they were actually banned from March Madness because they had APR scores that were below. It was a huge deal because mm-hmm. finally you have one of the big players that are now banned. And mm-hmm. so it's like, oh, what's happening? But that doesn't really happen. What really happens is the HBCUs, the limited resource institutions, are the ones that are banned, and nobody says anything about it. I do think a tiered system will have that impact of inferiority, and so that's why I honestly think they just need to do away with APR. It's not equitable, it's discriminatory, and it's inaccurate. APR does not achieve what it's supposed to do, other than becoming now, instead of being a rehabilitative tool, is now a punitive tool against HBCUs, discouraging prospective student athletes from wanting to maybe play or even attend an HBCU because of the stigma that comes with having low APR scores, and then further hurting the HBCU athletic programs, because then they're not able to recruit the high achieving, the high athletic talent that are now going to HWIs that do not have the stigma of low APR scores. And so it just has a trickling effect on both the institutional level, on both the student level, that I think is problematic. Furthermore, one other thing I wanted to add is this whole issue of why I think it's important for HBCUs to continue to stay at a Division I level and to continue to be able to play in postseason on a national platform is because prior to 1957, there was no platform for Black athletes to play on a national level. We just pretty much had the baseball Negro Leagues, which was important, but it was only for baseball and it was only for males. But being able to get NCAA status, granted, was originally at the Division II level, now it's at a Division I, it's important, and it's more important that they stay there to continue to have their presence and to continue to maintain access. And so APR, again, is just decreasing access to Division I competition, which is further decreasing access for students who are interested in playing at a HBCU, but instead opt to go to a HWI because of this issue with APR.